Brothers and sisters in Islam, from last week's khutbah, we understand that the best supplications and invocations were the invocations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if anyone has to see the worship and the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it will be clear that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the most perfect way. And he was always sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was always anxious and eager to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the best way possible. And it is for this reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to follow him in every inch of his life, especially when it comes to worship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا, that there was a uswa hasan, there was a perfect example for you to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it's from this understanding and it's from this basis that we Muslims, we turn to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to see how he worshiped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so we can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the best way possible. Because the best worship is the worship of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, any worship that contradicts the guidelines of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is rejected, it's returned to you. In an authentic hadith narrated by Imam al-Bukhari and also by Ibn Majah in his book, the book of hadith that Ibn Majah collected, once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went into his room, and in this room was his wife, As-Siddiqah bint As-Siddiq radiallahu anha. In this room was his wife, the mother of the believers, the most honest Aisha radiallahu anha. And she was praying salah, and she heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam come in, but she continued to pray her salah, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam waited. And as we all know, salah is a mixture of supplications and invocations and movements with the hands and the limbs and prostrations and bowing, all this to try and get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is exactly what Aisha radiallahu anha was doing. When she finished her salah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave his wife Aisha radiallahu anha the best advice in regards to supplications and invocations. So he told her, Ya Aisha, alayki bijumali du'a wa jawami'a. So he told her, Oh Aisha. So it's like he saw her worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all this time, and he wanted to give her the best advice to maximize from her time. So he told her, Oh Aisha, you should hold to the dua that have clauses, and these clauses, they are comprehensive. This is the advice that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave his wife radiallahu anha. He told her, you should supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should use the du'as that contain clauses. And at the same time, these clauses are comprehensive. They entail all good. And this was one of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he would supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using words that were very small in number, but they entailed the whole world in goodness. All goodness was, we found them in these words, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And amongst these jawami', how the scholars call them, jawami' al-du'a. Jawami' al-du'a are the du'as that entail all good. And amongst these jawami', these du'as that entail all good was where the Prophet says, and this is what he teaches Aisha radiallahu anha. He says, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-khayra kulla. Allahumma inni as'aluka al-khayra kulla. Ajilihi wa Allahumma inni as'aluka min al-khayri kulli. Ajilihi wa ajilih. Ma alimtu minhu wa ma lam a'lam. Wa a'udhu bika min al-sharri kulli. Ajilihi wa ajilih. ما علمت منه وما لم أعلم اللهم إن أسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول أو عمل وأعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول أو عمل اللهم إن أسألك ما سألك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وأعوذ بك من كل ما استعاذ به عبدك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وما قضيت لي من قضاء فاجعل عاقبته رشدا. Inshallah, we're going to go and look at each clause of this dua and look at how, what goodness it entails, what goodness it has. This dua has about 15 or 16 clauses, but this is the goodness that every Muslim needs in his life. This is the good that every Muslim needs. Every Muslim, despite where they live, despite where they live, every Muslim needs the good and the blessings that Allah, that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in this dua. So the first thing the Prophet ﷺ starts with in this dua, he says, Allahumma inni as'aluka min al-khayri kulli. Allahumma, rendering that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in his position on the arsh. And this is the manhaj of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. This is the doctrine of the scholars of the Salaf. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created the world, He created the heavens and the earth. And then He rose on His arsh. He rose on His throne. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, خَلَقَ اللَّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ فِي سَبْعَةِ أَيَّامِ ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى عَلَى الْعَرْشِ. So this is our creed. This is our doctrine. We don't believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everywhere. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created the heavens and the earth, and then He ascended on His throne, subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the madhab of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Allahumma, he's calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on His throne. He's calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on His arch. إِنِّي أَسْأَلُكَ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ كُلِّهِ. Oh Allah, I ask you from all good. I ask you from all good. Five words. When you call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using this, you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all good. All the good out of the millions and the millions and the millions of things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made. Because what's good for me might not be good for you. And what's good for you might not be good for someone else. Some people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just like that, He's blessed them with good health, even though that person didn't ask Allah for good health. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed that person with good health. Only the person who's been deprived of that blessing will understand the true meaning of good health. Ask that person who has kidney failure. Ask that person who has cancer on the true meaning of good health. They will understand it because they've lost it. So what's good for you will not be good for someone else. You might render something to be good, but is it really good? And in contrast to that, you might regard something to be bad. You might dislike it, but you don't know. Maybe deep down, okay, under the cover of that something that looks bad, maybe there's goodness there for you. And to further emphasize and clarify this, in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after He mentions and He mandates battle to the believers, and battle is something scary. No one likes to go to battle, because when you hear the word battle, you straight away think of pain and the fact of losing a hand, being cut off, the fact of being stabbed with a spear or an arrow. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمْ قِتَالُ وَهُوَ كُرْهٌ لَكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mandated for you to go to battle and you dislike it. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, عَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. Maybe you will not like something, maybe you will like something which is good. عَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ خَيْرًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ. عَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He says, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالُ وَهُوَ كُرْهٌ لَكُمْ. عَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. Maybe you will dislike something, but that something is good for you, because battle is good for you. You cannot compare someone who goes to battle and fights and gives his soul in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in return for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy and his blessings. You cannot compare the body to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in reward. And also, maybe you like something, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌّ لَكُمْ. And also, maybe you like some, maybe you hate something, but it's good for you. So going back to our dua, the Prophet ﷺ says, Allahumma inni as'aluka minal khayri kulli. Oh Allah, I ask you from all good deeds. I ask you for all good. Kulli. All good. And in contrast to us perceiving or looking at something which appears to be bad for us, but it's good for us. Many of us, we have this feeling, we have this notion that money is a good blessing. We feel that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to bless us and give us, open his doors of mercy on us financially, and we were to be as rich as some of the rich people in the world, we'd give more sadaqat, we'd open schools to memorize the Quran, and we'd do so much good. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but sometimes we look at these things as blessings, but they may not be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَلَوْ بَسَطَ اللَّهُ الرِّزْقَ لِعِبَادِي لَبَغَوْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Allah says, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to send his provisions, if he has to send his provisions all in one time, your whole salary, your whole 10 years of salary, it would have to come in one drop. لَبَغَوْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. They would be misled. وَلَكِنْ يُنَزِّلُ بِقَدَرٍ مَّا يَشَاءُ. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes his provisions, he descends them time at a time in a proportion. So this is how we, sometimes some Muslims, they raise their hands, and this is a mistake. They raise their hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, give me money. And these people that do this, they are not on the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught Aisha, oh, alayki bi jumali du'a, and he's one of these jawami' is, Allahumma inni as'aluka min al khayri kulli. Oh Allah, I ask you for what's good, all good. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, ajilihi wa ajili, because there's some good brothers and sisters in Islam that will come to you straight away, will come to you soon. And there's some good that comes to you later on. There's some good that comes to you straight away, ajil. And there's some good that will come to you after some time. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ, he didn't just stop and say, Allahumma inni as'aluka min al-khayri kulli. He said, Allahumma, oh Allah, I ask you for all good. The good that comes soon and the good that comes after some time. Because there's good that we will only see when our eyes close. There's good that might come to you after one decade. It might come to you after two decades. Just like a farmer when he grows his crops, he only reaps the benefits after a year of hard work. So there's some good that's gonna come to you after some time. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ used to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma inni as'aluka min al khayri kulli ajilihi wa ajili. And then he would say, ma alimtu minhu wa ma lam a'lam. Because this is another very important part of the dua. Sometimes you know something is good, And sometimes you don't know it's good. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. So sometimes you will know something is good, sometimes there will be something there that's good for you, but you won't know it. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hasn't given you the intellect. He hasn't given you the wisdom to truly understand that something that's in front of you. Just like battle, we look at it, and we look at it as something as we don't like. But if you look deep down, battle is a blessing. So sometimes, and this is why the Prophet ﷺ would say, Allahumma inni as'aluka min al-khayri kulli ma alimtu minhu wa ma lam a'lam. So, oh Allah, I ask you for the khayr, I ask you for the good that I know, and I ask also for the good that I don't know. Sometimes working in a certain company, it might appear to be that the salary is low, but working in that company is good for you. It's good for your faith, it's good for your health, it's good for your religion. So here the Prophet ﷺ turns the knowledge of the seen and the unseen, he turns it back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give him the message of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he knows is good. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the opposite. And then he would say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ash-sharri kulli ajilihi wa ajili. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say, a'udhu bika min ash-sharri kulli. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would seek refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all evil. The message that I'm trying to portray is that we should look at the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ when it comes to supplicating and invocating Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you have to open the books of sunnah, you'll find that the Prophet ﷺ, he sought refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in many things. In many things. You cannot talk about all these things in one khutbah. The Prophet ﷺ sought refuge from Allah in being in debt. The Prophet ﷺ sought refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in old age. How the Prophet ﷺ used to say, min al-ma'thami wal-maghram. To such an extent, one of the mothers of the believers, they said, Ya Rasulullah, you mentioned many times you seek refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in old age. So he says, a man will become old. He will speak and he doesn't know what he's saying. He will speak, he doesn't know what he's saying. You go to an old man, you ask him, what's your phone number? He doesn't know. Some old people, wal-iyadu billah, their nephews and their nieces come in the room and they don't know, this is my nephew and this is my niece, this is my grandchild. Because they've been overcome with old age. They don't remember what they ate yesterday. Some people get old to a level where they can't even go to the bathroom by themselves after living a life where they were independent. For so many years, he had the liberty of going to the bathroom by himself, washing himself, cutting his toenails, cutting his fingernails. But then he comes to a stage where now if he cuts his nails, he might cut his flesh. So now he's dependent on someone around him. He can't go to the mosque, he can't walk. And because of this, the Prophet ﷺ will seek refuge from old age. And one of the things that the Prophet ﷺ, he will seek refuge in from poverty. Because sometimes poverty can make you answer the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are many things that the Prophet ﷺ sought refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in. But in this dua, he brings five words that are comprehensive, that entailed he sought refuge from Allah in all evil. Every evil in the dictionary, every evil that's out there, that exists in these five words, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ash-sharri kulli. In these six words, he sought refuge from all evil that has ever been created. And then, just like the first part of the dua, he says, ajilihi wa ajili. Because just like when we spoke about khair, there's evil that will come to you soon, and there's evil that will come to you later on. There's evil that will come to you. There's bad that will come to you now, tomorrow, and after tomorrow, next week. And there's bad that's going to come to you after some time. And the Prophet ﷺ, he advised Aisha radiallahu anha to stick to this dua. And one of the meanings of the clauses in this dua is to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save you from all evil. The evil that comes soon and the evil that comes later on. The bad that comes soon and the bad that comes later on. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, وَأَسْأَلُكَ الْجَنَّةَ وَمَا قَرَّبَ إِلَيْهَا مِنْ قَوْلٍ أَوْ عَمَلٍ. Here is the overall, here is the final destination that every Muslim wants to get to. Every Muslim wants to get to Jannah. Every Muslim wants to get to Jannah. And the Prophet ﷺ understood this. And these were the things that were used to go on in his mind. That sadly today, many of us, because we've become so distant from the Quran and the Sunnah, because we've become so distant from his teachings, when we open our hands, we're asking for materialistic things. Oh Allah, give me a car. Oh Allah, give me a house. These are good things that you can ask for. But these are the dua that a Muslim should try and use and supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because these are entail all goodness. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-jannata wa ma qarraba ilayha min qawlin aw amal. Oh Allah, guide me to Jannah. Oh Allah, give me Jannah. And alongst Jannah, give me anything that takes me closer to it in speech and actions. Because out of all the things, there's so many acts of worship that can take you to Jannah. Visiting your neighbor when he's in need is an act that can take you to Jannah. Saying one subhanallah when you're alone can help you get closer to Jannah. Praying a salah when you're free out of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can take you closer to Jannah. Out of all the pondering over one surah in the Quran, even if it is two lines long, can take you closer to Jannah. And in this dua, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to admit him to Jannah and to guide him to all speech and all actions that take him to Jannah. So وَأَسْأَلُكَ الْجَنَّةَ وَمَا قَرَّبَ إِلَيْهَا مِنْ قَوْلٍ أَوْ عَمَلٍ. Another six words that entail all good. So when you say Allahumma إِنِّي أَسْأَلُكَ الْجَنَّةَ وَمَا قَرَّبَ إِلَيْهَا مِنْ قَوْلٍ أَوْ عَمَلٍ, you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you amongst those that are admitted in Jannah. And you're asking him to guide your speech, to give you the ability to speak what takes you to Jannah. Because the one that gets close to Jannah, it's easy for him to go into it. And then in contrast to Jannah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would seek refuge in the fire of Jahannam. And he would say, Allah wa'audhu bika min an-nar wa ma qarraba ilayha min qawlin aw amal. And every Muslim, in contrast to Jannah, every Muslim wants to avoid himself from going to the fire of Jahannam. Every Muslim wants to avoid himself going to fire of Jahannam. And this is why they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if they do mistakes. Every Muslim wants to avoid himself from putting himself into that in that situation where he has to go, where he has to go into the fire of Jahannam. And this is the Prophet ﷺ. He advises his wife, and these are the dua that he would say. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min an-nar. Oh Allah, I seek refuge from you in the fire of Jahannam. And don't only protect me by keeping me away from the fire of Jahannam. Make me stay away from all speech and actions that take you to the fire of Jahannam. Because how the Prophet ﷺ says in hadith, okay, حُفَّتِ النَّارِ بِالْمَكَ بِالشَّهَوَاتِ, the path to the fire of Jahannam has been laid with desires. You want to say, you want to do, you want to eat. And this path is full of desires, things that you want to do, things that we find appealing, we find good, we find calming. But in reality, these are going to destroy us. And then those people that don't understand, that don't speak Arabic, and they don't understand the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. In the next part of this dua, in another clause of this dua, the Prophet ﷺ would say, وَأَسْأَلُكَ مِنْ خَيْرِ مَا سَأَلَكَ مُحَمَّدٌ أو أَسْأَلُكَ مِنْ خَيْرِ مَا سَأَلَكَ نَبِيُّكَ مُحَمَّدٌ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. And I ask you, O Allah, in all the good that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, he asked you for. How is this different to the people? When they raise their hands, they're raising their hands for something which is materialistic. Something good, but it doesn't weigh the good that this dua weighs. And this is one of the du'as, how the scholars say, jawami' al-du'a. So when you raise your hands and you say, Allahumma, oh Allah, give me the good, I ask you for the good that Muhammad SAW asked you for. It's better than raising your hands and saying, oh Allah, give me this and this and this, and you mention it. It's better than saying, oh Allah, give me this and this and this. Because these six words, you've asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all the good that the Prophet SAW has asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. And in contrast to that, you've got وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ كُلِّ مَا اسْتَعَاذَ بِهِ عَبْدُكَ وَرَسُولُكَ مُحَمَّدٌ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. And I seek refuge in Allah. I seek refuge, I ask you for all the things, I seek refuge from you in all the things that the Prophet SAW sought refuge from you in. And we mentioned in the first part of the dua that he sought refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in many things, in old age, in being in debt, in poverty, in many things he sought refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in. And this is here, he's emphasizing it again. Oh Allah, I seek refuge from whatever your Prophet, your Messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sought refuge from you in. And then you have the last part of this dua where Allah subhanahu, where the Prophet says, وَمَا قَضَيْتَ لِي مِنْ قَضَاءٍ فَاجْعَلْ عَاقِبَتَهُ رُشْدًا. Oh Allah, whatever decree that you have decreed for me, whether it's good or it's bitter, make me a way out of it. Because brothers and sisters in Islam, a Muslim is going to be tried and tested. But the one who's guided, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes him patient if he has the decree that's bitter, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants him the ability to be grateful if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants him happy times. How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the hadith, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ إِنْ أَمْرَهُ كُلْهُ خَيْرٍ. Shocking is the affair of a Muslim, whether he has good times or bad times, he's in goodness. He's in goodness, he's in guidance. إِنْ أَصَابَتُ سَرَّاءَ شَكَرْ فَكَانَ ذَلِكَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. And if he has good times, he's grateful to Allah, he's ever thanking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's good for him. And if he's in bad times, وَإِنْ أَصَابَتُ دَرَّاءَ صَبَرْ فَكَانَ ذَلِكَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. And if he's bad times, if he has bad times, then he's patient like Ayyub alayhi salam. And that him being patient is good for him. وَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ إِلَّا لِلْمُؤْمِنِ. And this shocking affair, this thing where he gets rewarded on good and bad, good things and bitter things, this is not other than for a mu'min. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to truly make us understand the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to give us the ability to practice on what has been said. That was one of the du'as that entailed all forms of good that I encourage all the Muslims that are here, the brothers and the sisters that are here today, to start using, start memorizing. And this is these are the du'as that they need to start using in their salah, and also after their salah, and also whenever they make du'a. In another comprehensive du'a of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, every time he'd wake up in the morning, because when you wake up in the morning at Fajr time, this is a new day, you have a new chance. How many people don't wake up from their sleep? So every time you wake up in the morning, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from His mercy and His rahmah and His blessing giving you a new chance in your life to try and change your end result. Will you be amongst the people of the will you be amongst the people that go to Jannah without reckoning? Will you be amongst those Muslims that have to be purified and spend some time in the fire of Jahannam? And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us all and our families and our parents amongst those people that go to Jannah without reckoning. Ameen. Every day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would wake up after Fajr. He'd sit on his mat and supplicate, glorify to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would set his target for that day. And the people that look at character, they look at, they study how a human being can be effective. They say that every task you do, you should set yourself goals and targets. And you should try and meet those goals and targets. So every time you wanna do something, you set yourself goals and your targets. And you try and hit those targets, because that will help you achieve your goal. What were the goals and the targets of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? These were the goals and the targets of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the best man who Allah forgave all his future sins and his past sins. He'd wake up and say, Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafi'an wa 'amalan salihan wa rizqan tayyiba. These are the three things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would start his day with. He's just woken up from his sleep. He's now performed his salah, his fajr. Like it's been narrated in Imam Musnad, Imam Ahmed, in an authentic hadith, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after fajr, he would say, Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafi'an wa 'amalan salihan wa rizqan tayyiba. Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafi'an wa 'amalan salihan wa rizqan tayyiban. Three things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would ask for. And these three things, they entail all good. We cannot comprehend the goodness that these three things contain. The first thing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for is ilm, knowledge. And when he says nafi'an, we understand that there's two types of knowledge. There is knowledge that's going to help you, and there is knowledge that will not help you. There will be knowledge that will take you deep into the fire of Jahannam. And there's an authentic hadith on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he says, أَوَّلُ مَنْ تُسَعَرْ بِهِمُ النَّارِ ثَلَاثَ. The first people that will go into the fire of Jahannam are three grades or categories of people. The first one of those categories is a person who has knowledge. Allah will raise him. Allah will ask him, what did you do? He will say, I studied knowledge, O Allah. He says, why did you do it? He says, I did it so I can please you. And Allah will tell him, you're a liar. You studied knowledge so people can call you a scholar. And he'll be thrown down and he'll be thrown into the fire of Jahannam. And then a man will come, he'll recite the Quran beautifully in a sweet melody. And then Allah will ask him, what did you do? He will say, I recited the Quran. He says, Allah will ask him, why did you do it? He says, I did it to please you. And Allah will tell him, you're a liar. You recited it so people can call you a reciter. And he'll be thrown into the fire of Jahannam. And then will come the third person. And Allah will ask him, what did you do? He says, oh Allah, I was a mujahid. I took my sword and my bow and arrow and I went into the path of Allah to kill. Allah will ask him, why did you do it? He says, I did it to please you. And Allah will tell him, you're a liar. You did it so people can call you a mujahid. And he'll be thrown in the fire of Jahannam. These three people, their ilm didn't help them. Their knowledge didn't help them. And the Prophet ﷺ, when he says, Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafi'an, he says, Allahumma, give me that knowledge which helps me, which benefits me. It benefits me, my family, and the Muslims around me. And one of the things, going back to in the first part of the khutbah, one of the things that the Prophet ﷺ used to seek refuge from is knowledge that doesn't help. He would say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ilmin la yanfa'. Oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from knowledge that doesn't help, that doesn't bring any benefit. And the first thing when he would start his day, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, oh Allah, I ask you knowledge that helps me. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, he says, our need, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, the imam of one of the four imams, he says, our need for knowledge is greater than our need for food and drink. Because you only need to eat once or twice a day, three times a day, four times a day. But you need knowledge more than this in your day. How do you pray Salah if you're not going to have knowledge? How do you worship Allah if you're not going to have knowledge? So Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, he says, we need knowledge more than we need food and drink. Without food and drink, you'll die. But if you die on the correct aqeedah, you'll go to Jannah, inshallah. But without knowledge, you are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on how you see fit. So, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafi'an wa amalan salihan. I ask, and then the second thing he would ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for was, oh Allah, I ask you for to give me that deed, those deeds that are accepted. Wa amalan salih. One of the scholars, Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad, he was asked, what does amalan sawaban mean? What does amalun salih means? He says, that deed that's done in solely for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and is done in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If a deed is done for Allah, this is what Fudayl ibn Iyad says, if a deed is done for Allah and it's not done in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's rejected. And if it is done for some other person and in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's rejected. It has to be done solely for Allah and in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would ask Allah to give him deeds that are salih. Because sometimes we can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and our deeds are not salih. They're not accepted, they're not good. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, rizqan tayyiba. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, inna Allah amarakum bima amara bihil mursaleen. Ya ayyuhal rusulu kulu min at-tayyibati wa'malu salihah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us with the command that he gave to the messengers and the prophets. He says, oh man, eat from what's tayyib. Eat from what's clean and pure. And there's a hadith when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, inna Allah tayyibun la yaqbalu illa tayyiba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is tayyib, he's pure. He accepts nothing except if it's pure. Allah is pure, he accepts nothing which is pure. And because of this meaning, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, day in and day out, he would sit on his prayer mat after Fajr and he'd set his target for that day. My target for today is ilman nafi'an, for Allah to give me knowledge that helps me. And for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give me deeds that are salih. And for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give me rizq, to give me provisions that are pure. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, inna Allah tayyibun la yaqbalu illa tayyiba. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us with the same command that he commanded the prophets and the messengers. And he told us, ya ayyuhan nas, ya ayyuhar rusulu, kulu min tayyibati mimma razaqnakum. That, oh messengers, eat from what's pure. Don't eat from what's not pure. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima.